Next on Enviro Close-Up, the hoax that nuclear power is green. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I'm Karl Grossman. The subject, the hoax by the nuclear power industry and its promoters that nuclear power is green. There was a conference on this issue recently in New York City organized by the Radiation and Public Health Project. Actor Alec Baldwin, who has been involved for decades in challenging nuclear technology.
For me, there's always been, like a lot of people, something more spiritual. There's been something more innate that has plagued people about this issue. They know in their heart that they don't trust nuclear power. They know in their gut, and they're not scientists, but you don't need to be. The scientists are here to give us the facts, but most people realize that nuclear power has so many daunting issues that have never been addressed. Never been addressed in terms of beyond waste storage and beyond the terrorist threat now, not only for the reactors themselves, but for the storage facilities themselves. People in their gut now know that this is too expensive and not what our future should be. And throughout the 20 plus years that we've been involved with fighting the relicensing of places like Oyster Creek, we were involved in Millstone and now Indian Point. There's a gut sense we have that this is wrong, and today we're going to back that up with a lot of facts.
Dr. Gregory Jaczko, former chairman of the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission, he has a PhD in atomic physics, knows all about nuclear power, and he was thrown out of the chairmanship of the NRC because after the Fukushima nuclear plant disaster, he said we must consider lessons learned from Fukushima in any nuclear power proceeding.
I spent a number of years as the chairman of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and during that time, I dealt with a very significant accident, the Fukushima accident in Japan. In the morning when I first learned about the situation in Japan, it was Friday, March 11th, 2011, and I was alerted to a major earthquake and a large tsunami that had occurred, off the coast of Japan, which initially was something that we were worried about because that tsunami wave had the potential to travel all the way across the ocean and affect plants on the west coast of the United States. Thankfully, that didn't become an issue. The tsunami wave was not large by the time it got there. But you think about the magnitude of that incident, that it was potentially causing a wave to go all the way across the ocean. Well, much closer to where that happened were a number of nuclear power plants on the coast of Japan. And over the course of really the next 4 or 5 months of my life, I spent almost every day dealing with the aftermath of that earthquake and that tsunami. And that was nothing compared to the consequences for the people who lived in and around that community, and really for the entire country of Japan. Over 100,000 people were evacuated from their homes because of that accident. Many of them will never be able to go back to their homes, their community, their families, their livelihoods, the life that they knew. And when you hear a statement like that, and certainly when I hear statements like that, what I think about is there must have been a terrible, terrible tragedy, a war, a civil war, some type of conflict. But when you think about it, it was a nuclear power plant or a number of nuclear power plants that are there to generate electricity. Something is fundamentally wrong when we're dealing with a technology that is producing those kinds of consequences, and somehow we have not yet figured out that this is not the right way forward. When that accident happened in 2011, we were really on the cusp, I think, of really people everywhere recognizing that there were alternatives. Because, of course, the bigger threat, really, and I think we could all acknowledge that the biggest threat that we face right now from an environmental perspective is climate change. Well, when I was chairman, at the same time that I was dealing with the nuclear incident in Japan, I was also dealing with a massive push by the industry to regulate or to license the first new nuclear power plants in this country in decades. Four nuclear power plants, in fact, in the southern United States were licensed. I did not support those, largely because I didn't feel that as an agency we were doing enough to make those plants up to the most modern standards to deal with a Fukushima-type accident. So I didn't. In hindsight, that's looking like a better and better decision. But today, if you look at what's going on with those reactors, two of those projects have been canceled. Two of them continue at the tune of $28 billion. So on the one hand, this is a technology that has this ability for catastrophic accidents. It's also a technology that has been unable over its entire existence to be able to be executed in a meaningful, cost-conscious, responsible way. When you put those two factors together, they do not add up to a solution for climate change. In fact, what they add up to is, as you've heard, is a detriment to climate change. So what I see right now, and it's very interesting because I've lived through these incidents, I lived through the licensing of the plants in Georgia and South Carolina, and the promises at the time from the industry that these plants would be built on time and on budget. Because as I talked to the people on Wall Street who were financing or backing those projects, they assured me that if those plants were not built on time and on budget, there would be no more interest in nuclear power in this country. And of course, that's exactly what's happened. The industry has moved to the States, and what they're trying to do now is preserve these plants that are really no longer able to compete economically and are really losing out to better, cleaner technologies. So, you know, when I think of a solution for climate change, the thing that does not come to mind is nuclear power. And in fact, the solutions are out there. In California alone, in the last 5 years, they added about 11 gigawatts of new solar, which is about 11 nuclear power plants in that time frame. Well, in South Carolina and Georgia, they struggled to build four to the tune of $28 billion. So I think the answer is quite clear that the future for electricity is now easy. We no longer have to make a very difficult choice between the scourge of climate change and the potential radiation impacts from nuclear power or accident impacts from nuclear power. That solution is now clear. The economics are in favor of alternative energy sources, and the administrative, the ability to execute is on the side of those technologies. So, you know, as I look to the future, I think the future is very bright. What we have to continue to do is to educate elected officials that we no longer need nuclear power plants, that we can survive without them, and we can meet the climate objectives that we have. And so I'm really glad to be a part of this, for people to talk about that message and to get that message out so we continue, or we stop putting capital to things like subsidies for nuclear reactors, because that's exactly what that capital is going to. It is not climate abatement, it is subsidies for nuclear power, and I think it's time we move on from that technology.
Joseph Mangano, executive director of the Radiation and Public Health Project.
Our organization is a unique one. We're the only group, and that includes government, that whose mandate is to study the health trends and patterns near nuclear plants. And that's why we were formed just over 30 years ago. There was just a complete dearth of studies answering basic questions, like what are cancer rates like near nuclear plants. Since then, we've done 37 articles that have been in medical journals. We've written reports. We've written 8 books, and so on. And we do it because we know, and this is going to get into the other speakers a little bit, but we know that in addition to the waste produced by nuclear reactors, in addition to the threat of a meltdown, on a routine basis, radioactive chemicals are released into the environment by nuclear reactors. And there is a number of them. There's iodine, which goes to the thyroid gland. There's strontium, which goes to the bone. There's cesium, which goes to all the soft tissues. And all of them are, again, radioactive and cause cancer and other diseases.
Susan Shapiro, an attorney and anti-nuclear activist.
I want to point out that included in your press packets today is a letter from December 2nd, 2015 from Governor Cuomo, in which he mistakenly describes nuclear energy as being zero free emission source of electricity. This statement is not based in science and is simply not true. As Joe just explained, there are radioactive emissions that cause health impacts, deadly health impacts, cancers, but there's also radioactive greenhouse gas emissions and thermal emissions that are not considered when it's when the word zero emissions is being used for nuclear energy. Unfortunately, what has happened with this false, mistaken statement that Governor Cuomo made is that now it's been repeated so often that our elected officials and environmentalists have accepted it as true when it's not. And they haven't questioned it. And unfortunately, the word zero emissions has now become the code word in government policy for nuclear reactors, to fund nuclear reactors. So based on these wrong decisions, the New York State Public Service Commission gave the largest single subsidy ever granted to one corporation in New York State, $7.6 billion, to a Fortune 100 corporation, Exelon. And every single electricity user in the state is paying for it. It's every single month in our electric bills, there's a surcharge that's buried in the bill that is going to Exelon to keep the nuclear reactors, aging, antiquated, leaking nuclear reactors, operating. This was done as part of the Clean Energy Standard by the New York State government. The Clean Energy Standard was designed, the purpose of it was supposed to be to fund renewables and to move New York into rapidly becoming a model of a renewable energy state and going into the next generation of energy. However, what happened, because of lobbying, the Exelon ended up hijacking it and taking the lion's share of their funding. And renewables are only getting a very small fraction compared to the $7.6 billion that are giving to the nuclear industry. In fact, in the press packets as well, you'll see a reprint of the Crane's Business article that where an Exelon executive reported that he was boasting about how they scammed New York State and got a 750% return on investment based on the hoax that nuclear energy is zero emissions. So what Joe has pointed out, that these plants are not zero emissions, is one aspect of it. The other aspect of this is that the economics of it doesn't make any sense. It slows New York's economy. It slows our transition to green energy. And one of the worst things that's happened with this subsidy is that other states have adopted it as well. So now this is not just a New York State issue, but it's a national issue. We're dealing with New York, Illinois, Connecticut, New Jersey, and now Pennsylvania is considering this, quote, zero emissions subsidy for nuclear energy.
Dr. Mark Cooper of the Institute of Energy and the Environment at Vermont Law School.
You don't need a degree to understand pocketbook economics, although I have one from Yale. And somehow it pales compared to those kind of figures, right? But ultimately, it should be the pocketbook that decides these issues. So my analysis shows that subsidies for central station generation, particularly nuclear, will delay and distort the transformation of the electricity sector to a least cost, low carbon sector, because those facilities crowd out the alternatives. They have from day one, and they still do. Those subsidies will be a disaster for consumers and climate policy, not only because nuclear power is more expensive, dirtier, emits more carbon, creates fewer jobs, and stimulates less economic growth. Those are only the small reasons why we should be against it. The biggest reason why is that they will delay the transition to a clean energy future.
Assemblywoman Ellen Jaffee, who represents Rockland County in the New York State Legislature.
I strongly endorse the Green New Deal's call to completely phase out nuclear energy and support the closure of Indian Point as soon as possible. It is a major issue, especially lately, you know, the Indian Point, like all other aging reactors, including the ones that are being subsidized in upstate New York, has been experiencing real serious technical failures in the past month. Indian Point actually shut down about three times unexpectedly. This is not something, a new issue for me. In 2016, I wrote a letter to the commissioner, New York State Public Service Commission, and also to the secretary to the commission regarding the motion of the commission to implement a large-scale renewable program and the clean energy standard. But part of the problem here was the Public Service Commission had a new proposal to impose a nearly $8 billion nuclear tax on the average ratepayers, which was unacceptable, largely out of public view, and was being pushed with undue haste. I noted that in my letter, a very real concern. And this enormous tax would really be paid for by the working people of New York State, and it would be the nuclear bailout. And that was finally revealed in July. And without any of the leadership, the legislature and the community really knowing that this was happening, I noted how gravely concerned I was about the development in a case that was represented to be about supporting large-scale renewable energy. That's where we thought we were. But in fact, then they were moving forward to subsidize the nuclear industry, an industry that really was very difficult and not independently financially functioning and pushing on taxpayer subsidies now. In addition, I noted that it was enormous scientifically inaccurate. The nuclear energy was not renewable. Nuclear energy relies on uranium as fuel, which is a finite resource, and it's not renewable. I try to keep bringing these points to the table. Furthermore, nuclear energy production is not emission-free. Therefore, it is irrational for the Public Service Commission to include inaccurate, unscientific information on the basis of this bill that they were speaking about. And I was writing, telling them, please.
Dr. Mark Jacobson of Stanford University via Skype. Dr. Jacobson is a global expert on safe, truly green energy sources.
The cost has come down so much for wind and solar that you can actually couple either one with batteries now, and it's cheaper than natural gas for peaking plant, in terms of peaking. Since in fact, there are several states in which wind or solar plus batteries is actually replacing natural gas. So it just is really foolish to keep these dinosaur technologies going at this point. I should point out, in terms of emissions, as previous speakers have correctly pointed out, nuclear is not zero carbon at all. In fact, there are, aside from the fact that you need to continuously mine and refine uranium during the life of the nuclear reactor, and that's carbon intensive, but there's also heat emissions directly from the reactors as they're moving, as they're working, and water vapor emissions. And in comparison to wind and solar, just the heat and water vapor emissions are equivalent to about 7 grams of carbon dioxide per kilowatt hour of energy, on top of about 20 to 30 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour for the mining and refining of the uranium during the life of the reactor. So we're talking about 30 to 40 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour versus a life cycle emissions from wind. New onshore wind is less than 10, sometimes between 5 and 10 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. And that's all just in the beginning when you're building the wind turbine. And if you add the building the reactor, then you have additional emissions from nuclear as well. New nuclear is just completely out of the question, as has been stated already. It takes between planning and operation of a new nuclear plant 10 to 19 years versus between 2 and 5 years for a wind or large-scale solar farm. And that's what I say planning to operation. That's the construction plus the siting plus the permitting. And so, you know, we need to solve the global warming problem within the next 10 to 11 years, at least 80% of it. And if a new nuclear reactor is taking an average of 15 years between planning and operation, that's, you know, if we plan today, the next one would be up by the year 2034. Which is past the point where we need 80% of the problem solved. We see that new, even offshore wind is going up within one to two years in terms of the actual construction and another 1 to 2 of planning. China just, in fact, just put up an offshore wind farm, it became operational this last week, and it started the construction less than 2 years ago. And so it's just this long time lag between planning and operation of a new nuclear plant just makes it completely useless for solving the climate, air pollution, and energy security problems. So the last point I want to make is that these other problems associated with nuclear are so huge. It's not only the meltdown risk. 1.5% of all nuclear reactors ever built have melted down to some degree. And this, and the one, the Fukushima meltdowns, that's cost between $500 billion and $1 trillion to remedy that. And that's like, that's $1 to $2 billion per nuclear reactor in the world, just due to the Fukushima disaster. So this is a large subsidy that the society is already paying. On top of that, you have weapons proliferation risk, and especially if we go to have more small modular reactors that can be, then be deployed in other countries, it just makes it much easier for countries to, under the pretense of nuclear energy, import uranium and then try to refine it and extract plutonium and higher grade uranium to develop nuclear weapons. So that's a big risk that's unresolved. Then we have the waste issues. What do you do with all the nuclear reactor waste? And you have the mining issues. From a study that the U.S. did between around 1950, actually in the year 2000, 10% of all uranium miners died of lung cancer due to the fact that you have all these radon daughters that are carcinogenic that miners inhale. And so mining is another issue on top of waste, meltdown, and weapons proliferation issue. And you have the long lead times. And now the cost is between 4 and 5 times per kilowatt hour that of a new wind or solar farm. So it just makes no sense to keep promoting this outdated technology that has very, very little benefit for humankind.
In Pennsylvania, they're talking a lot about other problems besides cancer that nukes cause, like neonatal deaths and stillbirth rates. Dr. Gordon McLeod did a lot on that. And I was just wondering, if nukes can cause cancer, they can cause other things. And I'm wondering if you could address that.
Obviously, cancer is probably the most studied disease when it comes to exposure to nuclear emissions. However, it is not just cancer. And I'll give an example. In 2009, a book was published. The lead author was a fellow named Alexei Yablokov, and the editor is still a colleague of ours, Dr. Janet Sherman. It was about Chernobyl, and it put together a compendium of something like 5,000 articles, most of which were written in the Slavic language, most of which had never been published before. And I'll just summarize by saying literally every organ of the body was affected, all right? Not just cancer, not just birth defects, but the respiratory system, the digestive system. So yeah, it's not just cancer.
Most people in this country have busy lives. They go to work, they spend time with their loved ones, they're raising their families, they're busy with their jobs, they want to enjoy life, and they don't have the bandwidth, I don't mean intellectually, but in terms of their time of day, to absorb this issue to the degree that we are absorbing this issue, especially over the people who are the experts here. Forget about that. I'm just saying that, you know, lay people don't have the bandwidth, so they trust, as most Americans do, that the country's not going to put them in jeopardy in some catastrophic sense. They trust that. They have a contract with people like Cuomo, and they believe they're going to do the right thing. And of course, Cuomo is a politician who in the current campaign finance system, and I've said for decades now that campaign finance reform is the linchpin of all of our problems in this country, because it'll free elected officials to do their jobs. But instead, Cuomo is beholden to this industry. There's a lot of money in this industry, and he's beholden to people with money to maintain his power. And the other thing is, I want to go back to, and the last thing I'll say is about this NIMBY issue. Let me tell you something. In terms of the D&D of a plant, which would be, once they shut down, you're going to do the decommissioning and decontamination of that plant, which someone said, maybe it was Dr. Jacobson, is going to take 70 years. And what happens is, in the NIMBY sense, the whole country becomes the neighborhood that you don't want it in your backyard. The whole country becomes the place where, what do we get? We're down to what, 99 reactors now that are working? 98 from a high of about 105, 104. So you have 98 reactors that eventually are going to have to be dealt with, not just the waste. And that's going to be one hell of a NIMBY issue for people in this country. What are we going to do with all that waste and all that radioactive material? Not just the rods, but the buildings themselves, the complexes themselves have to be dealt with. that's going to be trillions and trillions of dollars to a country that's already trillions and trillions of dollars in debt. The energy industry offers no answers to that problem. All they're saying is, we got the answer that's the most important answer you really need, which is when you flick the switch, you want the lights to come out, and we know that's what you're relying on. When you flick the switch, you want the power to come on, and you don't want to ask any questions. You don't care where the power comes from. And what we're beginning to say to people is, we really, really do care about where the power comes from now. The debunking of renewables is one of the greatest crimes in American history. We need to start to tell people that if we build wind, if we build solar, if you have geothermal, whatever the mix and match is. So we do a mix and match all over the country. And what'll happen is if we knock down dependence on fossil fuels by 50%, isn't that something to dream about? Isn't that something to aim for? Not to eliminate fossil fuels, but to decrease our reliance on. And nuclear's got to go. Nuclear's in a separate category. And we must never, ever, ever stop distinguishing nuclear as being in a separate category. What nuclear achieves, the problems that nuclear creates, these people at Fukushima sat there and they said that the odds of this thing happening were like the odds of you getting hit by a plane while you were sleeping in your bedroom. A plane's going to crash on your house and kill you in your bed. It's so anomalous. It's just not going to happen, what happened at Fukushima. And look what happened. One of the worst catastrophes in world history in terms of this kind of thing. And we have to sit there and say to ourselves, enough. They don't get to decide. We get to decide. And those people who are in political leadership in our state and in our country who don't get it, they got to go. This is a potentially catastrophic issue for us as it relates to climate change, and we must switch to renewable power. I don't want to say Manhattan Project, because that bespeaks something military. It's more of an Apollo project. We have to spend whatever it takes. We have to spend whatever it takes to get us to where we're 50% reduction of fossil fuel usage through renewables in the next 20 years.
This has been Enviro Close-Up. I am Karl Grossman, reporting from a very important conference in New York City on nuclear technology, providing all kinds of information, things we need to know. For more information about Envirovideo programs, the series of Enviro close-ups, just visit our website at envirovideo.com.